Hey, it's John at Enduring Charm. I was recently cleaning out the house of an elderly family member, and I came across these two gems. These are miter boxes used for cross-cutting. There's this style, and there's this more elaborate style here. And before we had power tools, these were the kind of things we used for cross-cutting. And it got me thinking about how things were done in the old days. One of the things that's difficult even for people with modern power tools, is to cope crown molding. I've done several videos on how to do that, but I thought, hey, you know what? It might be fun just here in the shop to use these old tools, among some other tools, and to try to cope crown molding. I have a piece of scrap right here, using entirely hand tools, no power tools whatsoever. Now, this is the more elaborate of the two miter boxes. This is the Stanley number 115. And it has a fairly elaborate, for the back in the day, adjustments. So, you know, you saw back and forth. This metal guide keeps the saw aligned. And it has a pin right here you can pull up, and you can adjust the saw to different angles. There's not a lot of adjustments, and it's not a super accurate adjustment, but you can get your 45, you can get your 90, and you can get a couple angles in between. The height of this can come up and down. However, it is limited, not just by this right here. In other words, this can only go up so far, but the saw itself is also a limiting factor. And when I looked at this more closely, I realized that it would not be possible to cut crown molding in this box because there's just not enough room for the crown molding. Even if I raise this up, I can get the crown molding underneath, but then the saw runs out of room there. It doesn't actually complete the cut. So this miter box would not be appropriate. What this would be appropriate for is for cutting things on the flat like that. Now this miter box takes a simpler approach. And really, this is a plastic version of what carpenters back in the day used to make for themselves. So basically, there are some cutouts here. There's one here for a 45. And those guide the saw. Not very accurately, honestly, and this one has some damage here, but that was the idea. So the saw would go back and forth, and if you needed to do it at an angle, you would do something like that. There's even an angle here for a 45 that way. So this is a plastic version of what most of the carpenters would make out of hardwood. They would screw together hardwood scraps for themselves, and they would make the initial cuts, maybe using a guide so they get everything straight, and then that box would guide them on future cuts. Now, if I put a piece of crown molding in here, you can see this box could be used to cut crown molding because you can put the molding up on an angle like this, and there is enough of a fence here to support it. Now, let's remind ourselves what we mean by a coped joint in crown molding. When we have a corner of a room, the crown molding goes up like this, right? And there's more than one way we could connect that joint. One way is we could just cut a miter joint here and a miter joint here and have the two pieces fit together. The problem with that is that with expansion and contraction over the seasons, that joint will open up and it doesn't look very good. So instead of doing that, what we typically do is a coped joint where one side, it doesn't matter which side, but one side goes all the way into the corner and the other side goes up to that piece of molding. And what we need to do to make that joint tight is to worry about this section right here. So what we'll do is we'll cut a miter as if we were going to miter the joint. But instead of doing that miter joint, this goes beyond. And then we remove the area of this board that would interfere with the fit. That's the easiest way I can put it. I'm going to show you. Now, in previous videos, I've pointed out you always need to measure the walls because even if it looks like 90 degrees, it might not be. It might be 89 degrees. It might be 92 degrees. It's really hard to tell unless you measure. So we can't assume that a corner is going to be exactly 90 degrees and make our cuts based on that. Now, with a powered miter saw, it's very easy to get very accurate measurements. So if we need to go 89 degrees or 92 degrees, it's not a big deal. We can even go half a degree or even quarter of a degree in some saws. But when we're doing manual work, it's a little bit different. If we have just a simple box like this, how are we going to get, you know, a very accurate measurement for, you know, 89 degrees or something like that? It's going to be a little bit different. Now, As I said earlier, many carpenters back in the day would make their own miter boxes, so they wouldn't be using something plastic like this. This is really a homeowner version of what a professional carpenter might have been using. But there are ways, without modifying this, of adjusting the angle that we need. This miter box only has a 45-degree angle here, right? And if I need a 46-degree or, a 44-degree angle, that's a problem. I only have what I have here. Now, if I was making my own box, I might make a box with, a number of cutouts here. So I could make one at 44 and one at 45 and one at 46 if I wanted to. In this case, though, I'm stuck with this. So how can I adjust the angle? Well, the way that would be done is I would put this in here like this. And I need to adjust not the angle of the cut, but the angle of the workpiece. And I can do that with a shim. There is some eyeballing involved here. So I can adjust the workpiece by putting a shim behind it, right? And how much of that shim I use depends on what angle I'm trying to get. But by adjusting the angle of the workpiece, now there's a gap right here and it's touching right here. That also adjusts the angle of my cut. Similarly, if I needed to adjust the angle of the cut another way, I could raise or lower the workpiece from the rear, and that would change my angle. Now, you have to eyeball it, and a lot of it is some guesswork, and that was the art of carpentry. If you do this often enough, and you're using a manual station like this often enough, you get used to it. Even with power saws, I've done some of the same thing, where you just know it's a half a degree I need or whatever. And it's not that difficult. But when you're doing this for the first time, it is a little bit more difficult. So for our little experiment here, I'm not going to worry about that because I got enough to worry about. I'm going to assume we have 90 degree walls and give me that much. When we're cutting an angle at crown molding, the angle is with the molding in position, okay? So in this case, if it were exactly a 45 we were cutting, it would be like this. Well, if you try to cut this while holding it with your hand, it's going to weave and wobble all over the place, and that's not going to be very good. Same thing is true with a power saw, by the way. So what do? We want to support this edge and this edge. So in order to do that, what we do is turn it upside down. So this little doodad right here normally goes on the bottom. Now it's going to go on the top. And the angle will be the same. That's not the problem. We just want to support these two edges so that it doesn't move when we're cutting it, all right? To cut this manually, if I were to cut across here like this, again, it's really just my thumb holding that. I might get away with it, but it would be easier if we were to put some spacer in here, a piece of wood, anything, to hold this in place so it doesn't, move around like that. So that is what I'm going to do. I'm going to get this where I need it to be, take a quick measurement here, and put a scrap piece of wood in there to keep this from moving. It's also important when cutting manually to support the end here because we're going to be doing a lot of, physical motion. And if this end is moving about, that's not going to be helpful either. So I have a couple pieces of scrap wood here just to support the end. So when this is in position, this is supported on both ends and it's not going to be moving around on me. And another problem is that the miter box itself can be moving around. So if that's moving around like that, it's just difficult to get an accurate cut. You'll notice in this particular version, there's some screw holes right here. So this is meant to be screwed down to a surface, and that's one way to do it. Another way to do it would be to clamp it down, which I may do here, but you need some method to just hold this in place so that it doesn't move around on you. Okay, so there's no cheating on this little experiment, and I need to make a spacer to hold that crown molding in place, and I've measured what I need here. It's just shy of 2 3/8. I'm using this older saw. It's covered in rust. The teeth are kind of dull, but the other one that came with this miter box, it's not even usable. The teeth are so dull. So this is the best I've got. And this slides in here like this, all right? And I just need to find my mark, which is right about there. And then I'm just going to clamp this down. Now, back in the old days, you wouldn't need quite so many clamps because you'd set up a station where this is screwed down and you just wouldn't need this many. You might need one clamp for the workpiece, but because I'm doing this kind of temporarily here, this is what I've come up with. So I got my mark. Let me just double check that. That looks good. I'm still going to put my hand here and then just cross cut this. This saw is pretty bad, but let's see if we can get through the cut. Maybe this will knock some of the rust off. All right, so there's our spacer. One trouble with this box, I just noticed, is that the back fence is loose. So you can see it's actually moving. And when you're trying to make a cut and that's moving on you, not very helpful. So, you know, back in the day, this would probably be in better shape, but this is what we have now. So that's good. The spacer is the right size. This is tight against the fence. I just need to figure out a way to clamp this down now. Okay, that's going to be as good as it's going to get. I don't think this will be in my way here. So I still need to hold this workpiece, the crown molding, from going back and forth. I did not clamp that part, so I'm going to see if I can do that with my thumb, and I think we should be okay. It shouldn't be that difficult to cut. However, keep in mind this is finger jointed crown molding. It's cheap stuff. So if I happen to end up on a finger joint, it can be difficult sometimes, but let's just give it a try. And so I'm just going to fit the saw into both sides. Now it just barely catches the groove here because of the height of the crown molding. Ideally, this box would be a little bit taller, but this is what we're playing with here. So that's what I'm going to use. So I'll get that started. And I just let the saw do the work. All right, that's actually not too bad. Honestly, if this saw weren't rusty and old and have dull teeth, it would have cut a little faster, but you know, it is what it is. So there's our cutoff. Let's look at the quality of the cut now. I get up close here. I hope you can see that. That's actually pretty good. I got no complaints about that. This is a step you don't need to do, but for me, it makes it easier if I just mark the edges with a pencil so that I can see what I'm supposed to cut. I normally use a coping saw anyway, right? But there are other methods in the modern world. You can get a jigsaw with a rounded foot and you can use a jigsaw to cut this. You can use a sander, some people use. But I just like this manual method anyway, so this is not that unfamiliar to me. Now remember, what we're doing is we're going to cut at a severe angle here because we want to just relieve this area and get it out of our way. So what it looks like on the back really doesn't matter. We're just trying not to cut through that line. The one sticky part is right here. This little point tends to cut out on you, so you got to be careful of that. But I'm just going to take my coping saw. And I'm going to cut to the line, but not over it. And I usually hold my finger right here so I don't cut through that. I'd be a little more careful if I was doing this for a job. But since we're just playing around here, I'm not going to worry too much about it. All right, so that's that. Now, I'll take a file, and I'll just file up to the line. And I'm just taking a half-round file. Again, I'm not being too careful here, because we're playing around, but this is how I would do it. And that's basically it. I did take this tip off accidentally, which is not uncommon, honestly. And if I'm being more careful about it, it's usually not an issue. And this tip does sort of get in the way when you put these two pieces together. So, you know, if it's painted work, sometimes I won't even worry about it if it's just a little bit taken off. Anyway, that's where we are now. Now let's put these together and see what they look like. All right, I don't have a wall to put these up against, but if I hold it by hand here, you'll get the idea. So that, I think that's in camera range. That's your 90-degree angle. And it's a pretty good joint. I mean, I'm holding this here But yeah, that's pretty good. I don't have a problem with that. Once you paint and caulk that, it would be perfect. So manually doing this does take a little bit more time, but it's not a whole lot more time, quite honestly. So what do we learn here? Well, probably not that much, but it is interesting to see how things were done back in the day. I think the lessons might be that clamping and getting the workpiece as well as the miter box itself firmly attached to something is very important. If you try to do this where everything's all loosey-goosey, you're going to get terrible cuts. But if you do that, you know what? You can get a reasonably good cut even with a terrible old rusty saw. If you had newer equipment and spent a little bit more time on making a better home-built miter box, I think this would be a pretty decent method, and it only takes maybe another minute or two versus using a power saw.